Holger will do the first session today. Holger is my colleague, Professor Associato at the Venice Center for Digital and Public Humanities, and at the same time also has a position at the university in Würzburg. So he's has two positions at the same time. So very busy, as we all are. And yeah, Holger, it's the floor is yours. If you have questions, sorry. Okay, no, I'm quiet. I'm put myself on mute.
Thank you, Franz. I start the presentation with the usual disclaimer. I hope you can see it, but it will disappear in a moment. It's just the legal issue that we are recording the session. So I'm going to introduce you, hopefully step by step, to TEI, and we are going to do the first bits of encoding afterwards. Just to remind you, to refresh the context of yesterday's lecture by Federico, where you had a lot of markup in HTML. Today and in the following days, we will be concerned with XML, or more precisely, a subset of it, TI. And you can see in the schema where I would locate it in the genealogical tree, so to speak. Or if you prefer textual criticism, you can also consider it as a stemma codicum. The overview shows a kind of schema which should clarify the connection between the two. Both HTML and XML go back to SGML, the standard generalized markup language, whose specification were established in 1986. It contained already the individual tags in angle brackets that you saw yesterday, and the principle of strict separation of structure and layout of a document. So that's something that will follow us for all this week. Thus, within the document, an element of the markup can be used to specify that a string is, for example, a heading or subheading, as you saw. The way in which the heading is displayed, whether it is in bold, larger, underlined, and so forth, is determined at a later stage by the layout program. And many elements of the SGML live today on in HTML and XML. I don't need to go into more detail about HTML and just recall Federico's words that its focus is on the presentation of a text, not the representation. In contrast, the approach of XML was semantic, that is, markup according to the content of the document. Thus, a tag would be used, for example, to mark up a date or to indicate that a certain word was a person name, or that something is highlighted, without any implementation on graphical rendering or formatting. In fact, a semantic and a format-related markup are neither completely mutually exclusive, nor do they occur in their pure form. And so over time, both languages have repeatedly influenced each other. And you can see that with from the gray arrows, so contaminated transmission, so to speak. With XHTML, extensible hypertext markup language, a new formulation of HTML was created, which met the strict requirements of XML. However, the further development threatened to lose downward compatibility to HTML. And so finally, in a new approach, HTML5 was created, which combines and extends parts of both HTML and XHTML, with the addition of semantic components. And this approach is going to be further developed, so semantics will eventually also be present there or are already. So now to the text encoding itself. What is the point of encoding text? What are the purpose and the advantages of a standard? First of all, encoding serves to make explicit what is implicitly clear to the reader, thus creating the prerequisites for automated processing. However, it should be noted that this form of explication also has a heuristic and a documentation function. For the compulsive consistency enforced by the schema, for example, the consistent application of a certain semantic category may also lead to a specification of these categories and to a more precise understanding of the text. So constraint can also be a benefit. Conversely, the encoding also documents the encoder's understanding of the text and helps thus illustrating whether other views existed or may exist. In this way, different layers of annotation or annotations with different focus may be placed over the same text at the same time. We will see a simple example right away with the Marco Polo text, which has various overlapping structures or reference systems. One could either follow the chapter division given by the text or stick to the page and column division of the manuscript. By annotating both systems, we can automatically extract and display the same text for different purposes. For comparison, for instance, of the readings with the manuscripts, we will reproduce its format. For a comparison with other versions of the same story, the chapter division will be more useful. Text annotated in this way may thus be further refined or converted into other formats without repeating the basic work of annotation. So that's done once and for all. Now, the core of my presentation, TI. Some people might have suspected an error in the previous schema where TI was listed as an offshoot of XML. How can a text encoding initiative arise from a markup language? The answer lies in the metaphorical and metonymic language usage. In the beginning, in 1987, there was the text encoding initiative, a group of researchers who came together to create a standard for encoding text and literary and linguistics aspects. Figuratively speaking, TI then refers to this very standard and eventually to a subset of XML on which this standard is based. So we have three different meanings. Since the TI was established to develop, maintain, and promulgate hardware and software independent methods for encoding humanities data in electronic form, it has been extraordinarily successful at achieving its objective, and it is now the de facto standard for text encoding. On the TI webpage, you can find the latest guidelines, P5, P stands for proposal, various tools developed by the community and the consortium, and much more information about workshops, meetings, training, and so forth. Here's a screenshot of the website, the URL again repeated in the upper right corner. If you click on guidelines and then select the latest version, as I said, P5, you will get to this overview page. The documentation is quite detailed. The chapters on the right-hand side offer an introduction to the different sections. Information about individual tags or attributes can be found in the appendices on the left. I selected elements just to give you one example. That's the page of the element PB, page beginning. And traditionally, people also call it page break. I prefer the new name page beginning because it also reminds us to put it at the beginning of the page, and not maybe at the end of the page when you move on to the next one. the first lines in the schema provide a short description and a link to the chapter in the guidelines where the element is discussed in more detail. Below, there is a list of possible attributes and under contained by a long list of elements within which PB may be used or nested. It's part of the core group, so it may occur almost everywhere. When you start writing a new element in Oxygen, opening the Angular brackets, the program provides you with a link to the corresponding page of the guidelines. Thus, in case of doubt, you may always turn there automatically with a click. As a true subset of HTML, XML has some stricter rules for well-formed documents than HTML. Since 2002, TI is based on XML and thus following its convention. It has a more content-oriented approach, as we saw, and a more restrictive syntax. Federico explained yesterday that all elements must be closed and there may be no overlap of elements. The element names are case sensitive. The start and end tag must match exactly. When we take a look at a minimal TI document, we note the tree structure that starts from a root element, TI, and has two mandatory sub-elements, the TI header and the text. The separation of content and metadata, which is binding for XML as well as HTML, is important here. There are also other elements and attributes, such as the XML namespace of the TI root element. In the minimal variant of a TI document, the metadata must contain information about the title, publication or distribution of the document in the publication statement, and the origin of the text in the source description. This can either be a bibliographic statement in the case of a subsequently digitized text, or a sentence such as born digital for a newly created text. Other possible contents are comments, processing instructions, and entity references. These include the angle brackets, which are reserved to indicate element names and thus must be replaced or escaped by a corresponding sequence introduced by the ampersand. We saw that yesterday for HTML as well. Accordingly, the ampersand itself is again a reserved so-called magic character because it introduces the escape sequence. All XML documents must be well-formed, I repeat again, as it is a common source of error at the beginning. Each tag must have a corresponding end tag that precedes the end tag of the higher level, the parent element, and precedes the start tag of an element of the same level. The well-formedness can be seen directly in the document. The situation is different with validity, which is always relating to an external set of rules, a document type description, or a schema. This defines the sequence and the possible nesting of elements, that is the structure of the document, as well as the type and possible contents of attributes. The minimum specifications in the TI header I just mentioned originate from the XML schema of TI. So that's the requisite for having a valid TI document. Without these elements, the document would be well-formed XML, but it would not be a valid TI document. In total, TI offers hundreds of elements and attributes. In order to achieve greater uniformity in the coding of certain document types or within a project, subsets can be formed from them using new schemas. And a well-known example of this is, for instance, Epidoc TI. We will not go further into this aspect, and I confine myself to the reference to the Roma tool on the TI page. In Oxygen, there is the possibility to assign documents to predefined schemata. Examples are TI all, which contains all elements, as the name suggests. TI bare with the essentials, and TI light with the most common and most used elements. Before we go through the example document that forms the basis of the workshop, I would like to briefly classify our work into the typical workflow for digital editions. There are two levels, so to speak, the practical and the theoretical reflection. On the theoretical level, we analyze the source data and define a data model and schema. All that we take for granted in our case, in our workshop. And the practical level begins with the transcription of the text from the source. In our case, this has already been done by Elisa Culiana and Silvia Marsili, who generously provided a transcript, which you may find among the linked material on the GitHub site. The transcription is the starting point of our work. By encoding the text, the original bare string of characters is converted into a structured document in which the individual sections or certain semantic meanings are marked up. As Federico showed, the markup allows for a variety of visualizations that reproduce different elements differently depending on the target usership. In a printed book, for example, the chapter title may be placed at the top of each page as a running title, whereas on a web page, the same title may only be highlighted in color, and so forth. Now, let's finally have a look at our example document. At the beginning, there is a prologue in pink. It contains information about the XML version and the schema here, TI all. You can recognize it at the end of the second line, the TI all schema. In line 3, the content starts with the root element again. In the obligatory mandatory element file descriptions, line 7 to 8, we have first the information about author and title of the work, that is Les Livres du Grand Calme by Marco Polo. In the edition statement in lines 11 to 12, we have summarized the information about the type and origin of this edition. And in publication statement, you find the institution responsible for the release, that is our center, and the copyright, which is, of course, open access. The next section, I just walk you through the header. You don't have to do anything with the header now. We will expand on it later. The next section, source description, provides information about the source on which our edition is based. Since it is a manuscript, we have first the details about the place, Oxford, and the institution, the Bodleian Library, where the manuscript is kept, followed by the shelf marked, all in the element MS, manuscript identifier, line 23 to 27. In the following elements are optional, and we put them mainly for your convenience in the first instance. First, you see some basic information about the manuscript's contents. Our text is the third, starting on folio 218, the Marco Polo. Finally, some details about the manuscript's history in line 42 following, and some additional bibliography in the field additional. And you can see line 46, list bibl is a list of bibliographical entries. The link in line 49 brings you to the library's catalog page, where you also find a complete facsimile interlinked. We will use that later, but for the time being, if you want to refer to the image of the manuscript, you can also get there immediately from our XML document. That is the header. You can see in line 54 to 60 that we have mainly end tags. So we close all the tags we opened before and we move on to the contents. First, I want to show you the an image of the page we are going to deal with. Yet in the upper half, you have this nice view on Venice that Franz already described. In the lower part consists of the beginning of the text. We have a heading in red. I just zoom in a bit. Below the image, we have like a first title, two lines in red, and then two columns with initials at the beginning of paragraphs, which you can see on the left side. So here and here. I put in the transcription that you may access through get access in the Word document that we interlinked. And you can see that there is some markup, conventional markup in the text. So for instance, the title, the red part is in italics, and we have also the initials in bold print. If we compare this to the AI encoding, we are moving down to the body. So we had the root element, we have the metadata in the TI header. It should be closed here. I just used this for convenience. Then we move down to the text and the body, which has the main content. And we are going to use a couple of elements that I'm just briefly presenting to you now. So we have first div text divisions, which gives sections of the text. In this case, we are in the prologue of the document, so it will cover and embrace all the text and also go further on. If we look at an overview of this div element, text division, you can see that it indicates like books, chapters, or poems, whatever kind of textual source you text type you may have, and it uses attributes like number, chapter number, or book number. What kind of division it is defined in the type attribute, and you might of course have an identifier. So next in our document, we have a head that contains headings, and this would mark up probably our red two lines, which are here in italics. We also have another element. We have two paragraphs. I marked the first ones with the P element. This you already know from HTML. It's the same. Also, div is an element that is present in HTML. We have page beginnings, and here you already see that we have a different kind of structure, because the following three elements are empty elements. We are now dealing with the structure of the document itself, the manuscripts, not the structure of the text. These are parallel structures, and there might be overlap. That's also the reason why we are using empty elements for this, because if you look at the end of the first column, it's not the end of a sentence. So very likely the second paragraph will carry on. If we had another structure of beginning and end tags, there would be overlap. That is, a paragraph would start here and it would not finish here where the first column that starts up there begins. So we would have an element that starts within an element but finishes within the next element, and that's forbidden in XML. So we need empty elements to avoid this conflict, and they just mark the beginnings. So we can mark the beginning of the page, In this case, the number of the page would go into an attribute of the page beginnings in a number attribute. And the same may be said for the column beginnings. We would have one at the beginning here of the column and at the end, or that is at the beginning of the next column, and line beginnings on each line. In this case, on each line of the manuscript. So we would follow the manuscript. I just, for convenience, indicated it here on each line of our transcript, which is not following the layout of the manuscript, but we will have to put in the line beginnings in the proper place, checking with the manuscript. There are other features that we want to encode, as we have seen already in the transcript. We need the initials. So this means it's in a highlighted tag, HI, which indicates letters, sequences of letters that are graphically distinct from the normal encoding. And within the rend attribute, we can indicate how this is rendered in the manuscript. In this case, we are dealing with initials. And we can also here indicate the editorial expansions that are put in round brackets in the transcription. These are letters not present in the manuscript, but in a symbol, but they are not written in extenso, and supplied, expanded by the editor. So we put this into an X tag. If we put this together, we come to an encoding of the first paragraph. You can see I put in a div tag with the type prologue, and then a page break with the line number. It contains and carries on the head of two lines. We have the line beginnings, number one and number two, with the rendition of rubricated because it's in red. We also have an expansion in the second line, and you can just see it before the cut that I had to make to fit both on the screen. This is the per. You can see the P with the horizontal, and then we have the le of Le Monde. So we have the ER just as in expansion. And by annotating it like this, we can then decide how to render it. We can either reproduce an output as it was in the Word file that I copy-pasted in the original transcription, but we could also decide just to give the expanded writing without troubling the reader with details about how this, whether it was expanded or abbreviated in the manuscript. If we continue, we have here a column break. This is the first column, and it starts with the initial P that you can see here. So it's higher end initial, carries on with the line breaks and has some expansions now and there. And the last point we need to know is here we have an, I hope I'm correct in the line. You might not see it. It's we have a word that carries on, so illes. And to tell the, or to record that there's no word division, we have the attribute break equals no. This will allow us to render the text in a different layout, in a different line division. If we have a dash here, a hyphen, then we would have to get rid of it if we change the line breaks in our display. Otherwise, if we just record that there is no break, we can tell the system easily to carry on here from ill to less. And in the other cases where there is a break, which is implicit, we only record where there is no break, we would have simply an empty space instead of LB in the display. And so we can easily change the format and the layout of this paragraph. I'm already done with walking you through this first structural markup, which is mainly concerned with structure of the text and of the document. And I just present you the text lab instructions, which you also may follow if you are not participating in the workshop, because we have the starting document. So what I already showed to you made available in our folder, and a suggestion how it should look like once you've finished your work. So you can easily try and compare and refer to this document. So the instructions are very straightforward and simple. You open our document, which is called Tuesday 1 Begin. You get the transcription, the text from the Google document. I pasted the link for you, but you can also find it on our webpage. And you encode the content structure, so adding divisions, headings, and paragraphs. And also the document structure by adding page beginnings, column beginnings, line beginnings. This you can only do in reference to the image. You might want to check where the page beginnings are and so forth. And then we ask you to encode some of the graphical features of the document, like rubrications and initials, and the abbreviations. So that's 5-6 elements that you introduce in the first place to get some practice with the markup, to check how it works, to use some attributes, and we will then in the next steps refine further on the transcription and add more semantic markup, so moving from the structure to semantics. I'm already over the time, so I stop here, leave you some room for questions, and then meet you again in the workshop. Thank you.